On a clear night in this desert city, Tim Lay and his son look for the latest sign of the comet Hale-Bopp, an astronomical event that has been lighting up the night skies for months.
How's the Hale-Bopp tonight?
The same.
I've reviewed this case in extreme detail. The Hale-Bopp comet was visible in the night sky, and many people were in fact out to observe it. This case is unique because we have not only hundreds, but potentially thousands of eyewitnesses.
On the other side of Phoenix, Trigg Johnson and his family aren't looking for the comet. They're taking advantage of the cool evening air to do some yard work.
I've personally interviewed a number of the witnesses, both those who have been out in public and those who choose to remain silent.
Hey, what is that?
Hey, Dad? Look up there! That's not the Hale-Bopp, is it?
Despite the fact the Hale-Bopp comet was in the sky on that particular night over Phoenix, this in no way could have explained the formation of lights, which many witnesses said blocked out the stars as it flew overhead.
Trigg Johnson was a commercial airline pilot and was really familiar with things in the sky and things that flew. So his experience and his observational skills make him an important witness. And his first reaction was that he was seeing some airplanes in formation.
What the hell is that?
It's one hell of an air show.
It appeared as if it was some type of V formation of lights.
He thought that possibly this was a five ship of C-130 Hercules transports with some sort of giant lights on the front. It's hard to put oneself in the mind and the shoes of someone like Trigg Johnson, who upon first observation makes an assumption about what he's looking at and makes a best guess and decides, oh, I can map this onto existing technology. But as it got closer, the size and scope of the lights convinced him that this was not conventional aircraft.
The way it turns, so precise.
This set of lights didn't flinch, waver, move, or anything in rate, speed, or altitude. That's unnatural in and of itself.
The lights then started moving toward them. They then observed that these lights were not independent and were, in fact, embedded into a large craft.
Trigg said, I could land my commercial airliner on the top of this thing, whatever it was. So he's talking about something unbelievably big.
In spite of their initial fear,
I think we should go.
They don't move a muscle.
What witnesses have told me, including Trigg Johnson, was I did not want to take my eyes off this object. They were transfixed.
Throughout that entire period, we had hundreds, if not thousands, of eyewitnesses.
Tim and his son, Hal, were out driving around, and they had just returned to the house.
What is it?
The first time they saw it, the lights appeared to be in a row, and they were coming, again, from the northwest.
Why don't you go get your mom?
As the object comes closer, it appears to transform.
They described that it was as though they were looking at the stars being projected on the underside of the object. This has been alluded to in military circles as starfield camouflage. There's an object known as the stealth blimp and other objects that are reportedly designed to project the stars above beneath the object.
If the object has the ability to change its shape, or its perceived shape. Is that the same object if somebody else describes it differently? It's very important to understand that there could be as many as 6, possibly 12 different very large black objects floating around the airspace in Arizona on that night. Whatever these objects are, they're not doing aerodynamics. They're not deflecting air down, and they're not using any kind of conventional propulsion system, or we'd hear a lot more noise. Tim Lee's definition of this process was, it was deafening silence.
Suddenly, the object descends and picks up speed.
It got exceedingly low. It was really going right over their heads.
From the Johnsons' point of view, the object doesn't get closer. It seems to be sending a transmission.
Trigg Johnson and his family felt there was a communication given to them personally by whatever intelligence, if we want to call it that, was in the object. Something that we might want to call telepathy was employed to communicate with the witnesses. What was delivered to them was, don't worry, this is just a demonstration. What the meaning of that is and who would be in a position to project that into the minds of an observer and why they were giving a demonstration is one of the issues we need to solve with this case.
After nearly 30 minutes, the object appears to move away.
Look, it's leaving.
The object traversed the greater Phoenix, Arizona area, moving from the northwest to the southeast. When we take into account the silent flight, the large size of this object, and the unusual propulsion system, we're forced to conclude that we're dealing with a genuine unknown.
The same night, several witnesses capture video images of hovering lights. These come to be known as the Phoenix Lights. Phoenix City Council launches an investigation. Over 600 witnesses come forward saying they saw a UFO. An airman from nearby Luke Air Force Base claims that two fighter planes were scrambled and intercepted a flying object that night. Air Force officials deny this occurred and announce that illumination flares were launched at a firing range the night of the event. Days later, Arizona Governor Fife Symington holds a mock press conference in which he presents an aide disguised as an alien. But 10 years later, he admits that he too witnessed a craft of unknown origin.